Hello, and thank you for watching our CSCW presentation. I'm presenting on behalf of my collaborators at the Harvard University Graduate School of Education. In this research, we're interested in designing augmented reality experiences that are for co-located collaborations in which people are wearing head-mounted devices. Head-mounted augmented reality has become popular in recent years, and it basically allows people to collaborate with each other while using their hands to manipulate other physical objects. So in this case, in the middle here, we're seeing a lot of growth in the medical space where people can use augmented reality while performing surgery, for example. And we're also seeing it in other cases, for example, in engineering and education, where people are looking at a physical model and they are using augmented reality to understand it better or to design changes to it, or also to understand how to modify physical objects or how to repair physical machinery. And we're also seeing it in more generic cases where it's believed that having augmented reality for interactive meetings could be helpful because people can just display virtual content all across the physical environment and also be able to collaborate with people who are connected remotely and they don't have to be physically in person. And we're basically interested to understand, when designing these kind of experiences, what are the needs, the common needs that are needed by people interacting in these spaces, and what are features that have been designed to address those needs or to enhance the collaboration? In order to be inspired, we looked at different sort of environments. So there's environments where all of the people are wearing AR headsets and they're physically in the same space collaborating around AR-enabled content. There's also cases where one person is in a physical space looking at a physical object and they are collaborating with other people who are connected remotely, for example, through VR headsets. And then there's also cases where people are completely in a virtual environment and they're talking to other people who are also connected using VR headsets. And in all of these environments, people have specific needs that the system should be designed in order to meet. And there's been many different features that have been designed across the years, across these different devices. For example, features that are helping people to understand where their collaborators are looking or what they're interacting with. Also features, for example, for annotating objects and helping people to communicate with each other or leaving notes for each other that are attached to physical locations. And also features, for example, for helping people to manipulate virtual content together or for being able to leave instructions and guide other people together. So there's many different features that have been designed across these different environments, but there's no systematic understanding of like groupings of different needs that people have and also what kind of features are useful for solving those specific needs. So in this research, we asked what needs and features should be considered when designing collaborative, co-located, headset-based augmented reality experiences. And we answered this question using a literature review in which we organized the needs and features that we found in the existing literature. We looked at journals and conferences where they contained papers about augmented reality and virtual reality, and we made sure that all of the papers that got contained were existing real systems. They contained multiple users collaborating with each other, and they also used headsets. So we didn't want to, we were interested in headsets because it's a new technology, and we didn't want to include features that are only applicable for example, interacting with smartphones and screen-based devices. And we had some exclusions, for example, excluding review papers or only features that only work for virtual reality environments. And then we also excluded features that are not for co-located interactions. And our data set contained various types of papers, ranging between papers that only included AR, papers that included AR and VR or PC collaborators, and also some papers that included VR and VR interactions that were applicable for our subject matter. And then in terms of results, so we categorized a list of needs and features into 7 major groups of needs, in which we split them apart into 18 subgroups. So please see our paper for the specific needs and the example features that satisfy each of those needs. In this presentation, I will just gloss over some of the major categories. So one big category is this notion of sharing the virtual environment and sharing the activities between all the people that are interacting. So in this example, there's two physical people and they are interacting with this virtual content of a car here, but you can also see they're interacting with other virtual people who are connected remotely. Now, the devices that all of these collaborators are using need to be synchronized so that all of this virtual information is synchronized between them. And this is usually done through a network, and networks have issues with latency and bandwidth. And so there's been different kinds of features that have been designed in order to mediate the network connectivity. So sometimes it's not actually important to send all of the information across the network. So for example, in this case, it might not be important to know where each person's fingertips are, but it might be important to just know what the generic gesture is done by each person. So is somebody pointing at something, or are they holding something or dragging something? So in this case, the network interface is designed so that only the specific information is being sent, and so it creates a more smoother interaction. On the bottom here is an example from a different paper in which the eye gaze of people is being shared. So the system is using an eye tracker to show where each person's eyes are. In this case, it's two collaborators. You can see the two circles. And this network system is created so that the eye movement of the collaborator are being smoothed. So human eyes are usually quite jittery and they jump around a lot. But this network system is making it so that when you're looking at where somebody else is looking, their gaze is being shown quite smoothly. So in this case, the system is reducing some of the information that's being sent in order to create a more smooth experience. So these are some of the things that come into play when intending to share virtual content between multiple collaborators. Another need is being aware of other people, so knowing where another person is and what they're interacting with. And so this is, for example, one feature that's being designed in order to enhance somebody's awareness of their collaborators. In this case, you can see this view frustum, which not only shows you the direction in which a person is looking, but also how much of the surface area is being visible by the other person. And you can also see if two people are looking at the same shared space. And this helps with communication and collaboration. There's also some other examples of this. So for example, instead of showing this whole view frustum, you can just sort of show like a laser beam that's shooting out in order to indicate where each person is looking and what piece of space another person is looking at. Or there's also other features that are designed in order to show another person's just physical presence. So in this case, you can see there's a collaborator here. This collaborator might be virtual, or there might be a real person that's behind the wall. For example, in this case, the system can help you to understand that another person is there and they're working on something specific. So increasing the awareness between collaborators is important. And there's other ways to do this too. For example, there's x-rays that are designed into, for example, this feature that allows you, if there's a collaborator that's working on something behind this object, the system can allow you to see through the object at what somebody is working on. There's also another system that's being designed to monitor the tasks done by each person. And if two people are supposed to be synchronized and they become out of sync, the system can display some information about the fact that, oh, both of you are becoming out of sync in this task. In this case, the task is to carry this virtual object. And then there's also another case that you can do to enhance the awareness of somebody else's internal state. For example, with augmented reality, you could have sensors that are monitored their heart rate or their emotions or their cognitive load and display that to collaborators so that when you're just gazing at a collaborator, you can better understand their internal state. And then this doesn't just limit itself to awareness of people's states, but you can also be aware of what happened over time. So there can be systems in which the whole interaction between people is recorded, and then it can be replayed and analyzed by people at a future time. Or in this case, this is an older system in which the system is keeping track of what objects have been interacted with. And on the top here, it shows the user which objects have been touched and which other objects are needing to be touched. So in this case, it's increasing the awareness of what happened in the past during the collaboration. There's also a need for people to coordinate their actions. So if a task involves tight collaboration between people, one person might need to indicate what object should be interacted with. In this case, it's sometimes done through virtual laser beams, where one person is pointing at an object. You can also have these highlights around objects. And then there's other ways of coordinating activities, such as being able to annotate the space with instructions. For example, you have to pick up that object and then move it over here. On the right side here is just being able to annotate using arrows and instructions in order to take somebody through a sequence of step-by-step states. And there's also other features like being able to annotate points in space and leave notes for collaborators. And then there's also features that have been designed for manipulating objects. For example, when you're dealing with 3D objects, multiple people need to be able to grab onto those objects and manipulate them. There's also other systems. For example, in this case, this user can pick up a virtual object or take a snapshot of a real object, and they can move it to a different place where they can interact with it while another user is interacting with the real object. So in this case, this type of interaction allows two people to interact with the same object while at a distance. And there's other types of manipulations. For example, in this case, it's examples from two papers which are taking the input from two people and they're merging it together so that if one person is trying to drag this object one way and another person is trying to drag this object in a different way, the system is merging the inputs so that the object's position, or in the right side here, the object's rotation, are being merged so that people can collaboratively manipulate objects at the same time. And then finally, there's needs that people have in relation to personalization and privacy. In this case, this is an example of people learning about a physical system. And different learners can have access to different kinds of information depending on what they're interested in. So on the left here, you can see that there's magnetic fields being shown, there's audio waves, there's electricity, all kinds of information is being shown here. But on the right side, this user has decided that they only are interested in a specific layer of information. And so you can have a system in which two people are collaborating, but each one of them is seeing a different kind of thing depending on what they're interested in. And there's been different sort of systems that are designed for how do you indicate what objects are visible to whom and how do you hide objects from other people. And then this is an interesting system in which people are interacting with the same objects, they're seeing all kinds of virtual information, but the virtual information that they see is personalized according to the language of the user. So in this case, both people might be seeing this information about what they're interacting with, but the language is in a different language depending on what the user's preferences are. So all of these features are meeting specific kinds of needs that are available in a collaborative setting. And through this review, we basically grouped these needs and the features that can satisfy them. Now, I want to acknowledge some of the limitations, which is that there's quite a limited literature on interacting with 3D physical objects. So object tracking is quite a limited technology, and so we haven't seen a lot of technologies that create features about that. So in the future, we'll probably see different kinds of features as the technology evolves and as people can manipulate more physical objects. We also saw that there's quite a small size of the space when people are collaborating in a collaborative space. There are usually lab studies in which people are quite close to each other, but in the future, when AR devices are widely applicable, people are going to be at a distance from each other. And so that might be different kinds of features that are designed for that, including potentially the interest from remote assistance, where people can remotely connect to people in a physical space. And then finally, not all the features that are discussed in this review. So there might be features that are not actually discussed in this review because they are either they just weren't covered in the literature or they were very domain specific. So for example, in collaborations around surgery, there might be some very specific interactions there about people doing surgery. And so we haven't covered those. And also there might be other higher level features that are not discussed. So for example, there's a human need to care for other people, but that need is so generic that it hasn't been captured in this review. So thank you so much for watching our video. And if you have any questions, please feel free to contact us. Thank you very much.